fading bullet.
If you only knew the power of the dark side.
Able to leap tall buildings at a single bound.
There's more to them than meets the eye.
Thank you. Hey there, boils and ghouls, the one and only Chuckles the Clown here, and this is time for your reality to be non-existent, George Garner. This is...
I never live in reality.
This is what we call fan fiction part. This is where... And I've been looking this up. I think I am the only radio jockey that does this, that comes up with two original ideas, which tonight's ideas, if you guys didn't get it from the beginning music, it's about the Guardians of the Galaxy crash landing on a planet that is loaded with xenomorphs.
Okay.
Now, never have the aliens crossed with the Marvel Universe. They have crossed with DC and countless other comic books. But
Dark Horse, everything. Yeah.
Never.
Not Marvel.
Marvel. Out of all the groups that you would think would encounter these creatures, would be the Guardians, because these gentlemen are constantly, they're out there in space going after, doing what they got to do. If you're not a Guardians of the Galaxy fan, that's okay. Still stay and listen. You don't have to be a big fan of it. If you're not a fan of aliens and you're a fan of Guardians, stay and listen anyways.
If anybody's listening to the show, they're a fan of aliens.
That's what I'm saying. And this is the best part of this show. You, the listeners, are going to be able to come up with the ending, like we did last time with the Hulk versus Green Lantern. However, that didn't work out too well. I got more death threats than I did endings. So,
well, a death threat is an ending in a sense.
Yeah. There are a lot of angry DC Lantern folks when I had the way that the story ended there. But the problem was that story was there wasn't really an ending. So if you got angry at that, that's your own fault because you didn't come up with the ending.
You're lazy.
Yeah, exactly. Tony Jones said it great. You're lazy. I gave you the tools to do it yourself. This time, you guys are listening, come up with the ending, write it down, and send it to the Chuckles and Laughs Show at yahoo.com. Afterwards, I will pick which ending I like, and next time we're on air, I will read the ending, and you will receive an 8x10 signed autograph of myself. I know, big time money, but that's all I can afford, folks. Enjoy it. Well, and I hope you enjoy tonight's topic of Guardians versus Aliens. I know I took some time to write this down, but before we get going, I'd like to say thank you to Connecticut Comic Con and all the fans that came down to see me for just a Sunday.
I was what a blast, yeah.
Yeah, that was an awesome time. I can't wait to do it again. The Clown has officially stepped foot in Connecticut and has business terms in Connecticut. What does that mean, ladies and gentlemen? The Clown is officially in the tri-state area, not just Rhode Island, not just Massachusetts, but Connecticut. Sooner or later, I won't just be your New England horror clown. I will be your United States horror clown, and I will make it to that point.
Does that mean you're going to win the U.S. championship? Are you going to be the new face of America?
I will. Maybe I'll run for presidency next time against The Rock next time he's going and Donald Trump.
Yeah, well, I was going to point that out. First of all, we do have a United States horror clown. So you're going to have to. You have some stiff competition there if you want to take over that position.
Boy, could I get somewhere with stiff competition with some of the fans that were sending me pictures. But we won't get to that right now.
Oh, cosplay.
Yeah, the wife will probably kill me.
Yeah, the other thing I want to point out, though, too, is you telling me that you're going to become the United States evil clown. I mean, that's not news to me, because if you remember, I told you that you were going to reach that pinnacle of evil.
And I appreciate it. When I get that popular, George, you will be my official beer tester. You don't have to do a thing but test the beers that I go to in each state. Unfortunately, you might get that one or two that are skunked.
Diarrhea.
What a great night. Not only do we have fan fiction, but we have Dio on Rust, we have Guns N' Roses, Judas Priest, AC/DC, and King Diamond. This is a night of metal. That means that there's no messing around. This is pure fight tonight, and that's how I like my fan fiction.
No white boy hip-hop, in other words.
That's not until 1992, which is coming down the road. Which, by the way, the 1991 did really well with the ratings. And thank you, George, for being on that, and Tony for that one. Now let's start this story out, because it's a short, but it's a long one. And the Guardians of the Galaxy, as we all know it, the names in there, the galaxy, they travel the galaxy for adventures and saving people and sticking up for folks. And a lot of times they end up teaming up with the Avengers. But this time they've breached through a hole, and a wormhole in outer space. And this time when they breached through, it appears that they have come across a bunch of dead planets. There's no light to any of these planets. There's no sign of life. There's no sound. Remember the saying, in space, no one can hear you scream. Well, we're going to see if that's true with the Guardians here, because in a matter of seconds, they are clipped by a suspicious spaceship, let's put it that way. They are clipped, that causes them to crash into another planet that is ice cold. So their ship, which is called the Milano, which I found out, I didn't know this, but they named their ship after Alyssa Milano. Huh. Didn't know that. There's some Guardians of the Galaxy facts for you. And that was for the movie, of course. And the ship would crash inside this snowy area. Very cold. I'm not saying like poodle cold. I'm saying probably like Wisconsin cold. You know, you would need a jacket to come down in this area. There's no signs of trees. Nothing. Just nothing but blanketed snow and where this ship has crashed. The Guardians aren't stupid. They've been to countless planets, and the first thing these guys are going to do is they're going to run. And I'll give the credit to Gamora, because if you haven't seen the movies, do, George, because mm-hmm. the young lady that plays Gamora and puts the green paint on, she is gorgeous. They do a really good job with the female Marvel characters, where you're like, well, I wonder what they look like out of that paint.
Right.
And they did a really good job with that. But Gamora would scan the area with a life source or is checking out to see if the air is breathable. And sure as hell, the air is breathable. So at this point, the Guardians will have to get out. They'll have to assess the damage to their ship. First of all, what the hell hit them? This is supposed to be a dead galaxy. So they're going to get out. They're going to check their ship out. And stuff is going to start deteriorating from there. All right, so after running the scans, and they're all walking around, they notice that the ground is unsettled. It kind of looks like it's moving. And you look to the ground, and it looks like there's possibly a frozen earthworm or something underneath moving. That's how you can see the snow moving and everything inside there. None of them to get too edgy and react to it and shoot at it, because that's the worst mistake you could do. Although at this point in time, it probably would have been the best thing they did was to shoot at it, because popping out of the snow, yes, ladies and gentlemen, let's introduce the xenomorph, the critter that does not need air, does not need heat or cold to survive. It is basically a bug, right? Wouldn't you say that a self-stained bug of outer space?
Close, yeah.
Nasty as nasty can get, adaptable as adaptable can get. They are like the cockroaches of the universe. These things would pop out of the snow. They are a clear white and blue color, so you can almost see their internal areas. They have used the snow and the cold as a way to adapt for camouflage, and the Guardians are not going to know what to do with this, first of all. They've never met this thing, so what do you think they're going to do first, George? You think they're going to pop at it? You think they're going to try to assess the situation? We'll find out, but before we do that, we're going to go down and hit some music, because I told you we would. And this is one of my favorite Dio songs, and it's Dio's Sunset Superman here on Chuckles Crypt, RhodeIslandFreeRadio.org.
Thank you.
Hey there, boils and ghouls. Welcome back. And while we were on break, we were all talking about this, the aliens and stuff. But sure enough, if you haven't listened, we're talking, you're just tuning in, we're talking about the Guardians meets the Xenomorphs. And if you don't know what a Xenomorph is, I'll say this correctly for you guys out there. It's an alien. You're not a, like Tony said, you're not a nerd. Why do I say Xenomorph so often? Because alien is such a boring term, and it's used for so many
species. It's a generic term.
Right.
I could use like two or three aliens to help me around here at the studio if they're looking for work.
Exactly. See what I mean?
The one standing out in front of Home Depot.
But if I say xenomorph, everybody automatically, if you are a real science fiction nerd, know what I'm talking about.
Right.
Now, if I'm saying the Guardians, I'm meaning the Guardians of the Galaxy. I'm not going to say the full thing the whole time We call on the Guardians. George, you said earlier that you haven't really read up on the Guardians.
No, I mean, I know what they look like. I know of them. That's about
right.
It.
I am with you on that. I am not a full-fledged Guardians fan, so don't strike me down, people listening, and we'll get back to the story in a second. I do like the movies, and I do like certain books of theirs.
Right.
But I don't go gaga and collect the whole Guardians, the Galaxy collection. I am an Avengers fan. I do enjoy when the Avengers team up with the Guardians. That's a fun series, and you're going to be seeing that down the road in the movies. So, as we said, the Guardians have landed on this ice-cold planet, and now the Xenomorphs are starting to pop up. One of the first characters to get attacked is Guru, which, if you all know out there, Guru is basically a tree. So why would an alien want to attack a tree? So they would pull this creature down. They would bite at it and find out, well, this thing really isn't anything edible. We're basically biting at a walking tree. Before these bugs would figure this out, because they're not that bright, Garut would grab them and squish them. Big mistake. Because normally the brute strength of squishing something with Garut would work to his beneficial. But squishing these aliens, not a good one. Because we all know when you make an alien pop, you get the nice acidic drink with it. An acid and wood.
Doesn't acid mix. It's
corrosive, so that would definitely burn Garut's hands and whatever else was inside of it. Not enough to kill him, but enough to hurt the guy to the point where he's like, ow, that hurt. Yeah. I think that would be the first words he would say after saying, I am Garut all the time. He would finally say, this hurts.
Yeah, well, we need to do it at some point, too, for those of us who are novice Guardians followers, is maybe kind of run down kind of like the scorecard, right, characters and powers.
All right, let's do this.
Something like that.
I like that. I like what you were saying. Now, there are a lot of Guardians, just like there are a lot of Avengers. So I took the basic Guardians that people know. I took Drax, which is in the movies, he's Batista, and he's like red and gray, and he's got super strength. He's not really anything to write home to mom and dad about. You got Gamora, which is one of my favorites. She's a daughter of Thanos, and she's an excellent wielder of swords and weapons, and she is very knowledgeable. And then we got Rocket Raccoon, which, out of all the characters, when I said it, when I was watching this, I said Rocket Raccoon and Drax are the stupidest characters I've ever met.
See, that's one of the reasons it's hard for me to get my enthusiasm around this group.
But give it a chance, because as stupid as they are probably the best part of the Guardians.
Okay,
they are hysterical. And Rocket becomes one of those characters where he kind of grows on you.
Okay, now his origin, though, is
he's a creation. He's a creation of what he is. He's a lab creation. Now, he's also a master of weapons, really good at weapons and assassination. You'd like this guy. He likes to kill things. And then you have Star-Lord, which is an everyday human being like you and me, that in the movies they have him being the son of Oa, which is a living planet, or
Ego.
Ego. Sorry, Oa was Oa is Star. It's Green Lantern. Sorry. And then you have Groot, which is a tree, and he's very unkillable, but he's pretty stupid. He's strong, but he has all the powers of a growing tree inside of him. Really creative character. And then Mantis I put in there for the hell of it, because I thought the girl playing it.
Well, Mantis is cool.
Yeah, and the girl that played her was hot. And Mantis is one of those characters that can like read your feelings and everything and mess around with what you're doing inside there. So these are the ones that I have crash-landed on the planet. Now, scorecard right now, not doing so well. You got a character who has squished the aliens, and he's pretty much burned his hands. Now, of course, if you guys don't know, which, George, you might not know, Rocket and Garut are best friends. So if Rocket saw something happen to Garut, he would get very upset, get very trigger-happy, and start pulling the trigger. And there'd be aliens popping everywhere because this guy doesn't miss. So whatever's popping to the surface, they're going to start to get popped. And there's going to be green acid mixing with snow, which is going to make visibility in this area very hard, because all the acid and the snow is going to create a fog, which is going to come up, and it's going to work to the aliens' advantage because they don't really need to see inside of that stuff. However, the humans do, and the creatures inside of there do. So they're one down. They've just made the mistake of making the environment to the point where the aliens are going to be more apt to succeed than themselves. And I'm not doing this saying I'm a bigger fan than aliens before someone calls up the radio station and says, "Unplug Chuckles a Clown. He is biased against the Guardians."
Well, you know what? Let me just insert here. I think whenever you do one of these matchups,
yep,
under whatever the circumstances, you can't avoid a certain little touch of bias. I mean, as soon as you have two sides in a battle, I mean, we all have a slight bias as to who we want to see win.
Of course we do.
I mean, the only way we wouldn't do that is if we just hated both of the people, both of the combatants involved.
Both die.
Yeah. And a big meteorite comes down and crashes, and the dinosaurs are all over. No, that's not what we're doing here. But what we are doing, we're already down one. The environment's not looking so good. So Drax decides he's going to back it up to try to get himself some cover. Backs himself up behind the spaceship so he has himself some cover so he can pull some weapons. And he starts shooting in every other direction. Of course, Rocket and all of them are trying to back themselves up so they're not getting shot, because Drax is starting to flip out now because of this area. The next person that goes down, unfortunately, is the one that you like, Mr. Garner.
Of course it is.
Yeah, it had to be her. I'm sorry, but Mantis is the next one that's attacked. From out from the underground, the creature pops up, tackles her to the ground there, and she stops the jaw, stops it from snapping right inside of her face. But she's holding the head, trying to feel what sort of emotions this creature has, and all she can feel.
And it doesn't have any.
It does. It has the emotions to listen to whatever's powering it to do what it's doing. So all she can feel is this thing's desire to make sure that whatever food or baiting stuff is brought back to the queen.
Now, this brings up an interest. Let's stop right here for a second.
Mm-hmm.
Because now, as enthusiastic a fan of the Alien franchise as I am, this brings up a question I never really thought of. See, I've always thought of the Alien Xenomorphs as kind of Terminator-like, half, what do you say, you know, the old cliche, you know, half alive, half mechanical.
Right.
I mean, I've always understood that these creatures are not, you know, they don't have mommies and daddies. I mean, yes, they come from eggs, but they're genetic constructs, more
right,
like the raptors in Jurassic Park. In other words, so, interesting question. Do aliens eat?
Of course.
What do they eat? And
anything they can get their jaws on, they eat.
No, they attack. See, they attack.
Mm-hmm.
In other words, they attack the same way that, like, hornets attack anything that goes near their nest.
Mm-hmm.
They have a homicidal streak in them, which goes with them being genetically improvised weapons. But when did we ever see them eat?
Well, you see it a lot in the movies.
They bite people's faces off, and they bite off arms and legs.
I know you don't like this one, but if you watch Aliens 3, you can see him actually feasting on the prisoner that's in the tunnel. The thing's going down.
Chewing away at
him. Although I think when he comes up, there's blood all over
it. I remember that. But I mean, but I guess it's the same question as, like, in a Godzilla.
Mm-hmm.
Do they eat actually because they eat for nourishment, or do they just take bites out of things just to chew them up and kill them?
I think it would be both.
No, you follow what I'm saying?
Yeah,
I mean,
yeah.
It's a meaningful question.
Yeah. I would put them under the same wave as an ant. Ants kill to kill, but ants do have to eat to survive.
No, that's just, it's funny. So, this conversation brought it up. Do these alien xenomorphs actually need to eat?
So I would say I would put them under the same characteristics, because they act very similar to an ant,
mm-hmm,
where they have to, like, themselves have to make sure that the queen is satisfied. But the same sense, if they're not moving around by nourishing themselves, because they have organs and whatnot inside of them. They're not going to be able to do what they're supposed to do. If you are a fan of the Alien franchise, you will find also if they do not have other beings to eat, they will turn cannibalistic and they will kill each other and eat each other.
See, that makes a little more sense, though, because I guess, you know, now we're getting really nerd depth here.
Oh, yeah.
But that's okay because we're on the Chuckles Crypt, right?
Yep.
What the hell would an alien xenomorph eat to translate whatever it is that they take in to acid blood? You follow what I'm saying? In other words, like, I'm thinking of, like Gamera, the space turtle, right? Drinks hydrocarbons. So, in other words, you follow what I'm saying? In other words,
I will answer
food,
that
there's
for
food
you.
Food and then there's food. Good, go ahead.
I will answer that for you in a little bit, but let's finish what's going on here with Mantis, and we come back, and I will answer your question on how they get acid blood. Now, as we said, Mantis is she's holding the head. She's trying to stop it from eating her. We won't go down that route again. And all of a sudden, the alien's second weapon, its tail, slides up and goes through her abdominal. So she might have been able to stop the mouth from chewing her up, but she wasn't going to stop the tail. As we all know, ladies and gentlemen, aliens are killing machines. You just got to that.
Yep.
Everything on them is meant to kill. They are a superior species when it comes to killing things. Now, she was murdered by this alien, and the first thing good old the star does is he decides to launch a round at the alien. Boom. So any chances of Mantis surviving is gone now because he just exploded the thing on her.
Acidically dissolved.
And she's starting to chew up. Now we're down. One guy's burned. One guy or one young lady has been eaten. And they're starting to freak out. This is a situation where they have not been inside of yet. They haven't even been able to assess these animals. They have jumped on them right away. That would tell you right there that the animals are ready to eat. And they're ready to eat anything that moves inside of there. So we're going to go down to some music, and we'll come back to, I will answer George's question, how to get the acidic blood, because I have read that inside of a book, ladies and gentlemen. Not a comic book.
We don't need no stinking books on this show.
Yes.
You're fired.
Thank you. I appreciate it. Can I get an extra zero in my pension? And this would not, definitely this situation would not be a paradise city for the good old Guardians of the Galaxy. It wouldn't be a paradise city for any of us. Neverline, Guns N' Roses, here on Chuckles Crypt, RhodeIslandFreeRadio.org, where we are talking fan fiction.
Girl, I'm putting down. I want to please me home.
there, boys and ghouls, and we are back to the Guardians crash landing on the good old ice planet loaded with xenomorphs, and it's not looking good for them, George.
No, Mantis is dead, you son of a bitch.
Mantis is dead. Groot's got his hands burnt off, and he's pretty much sitting there looking like what just happened. And now Mr. Good old-fashioned Star-Lord himself is sitting there in shock. He just caused the death of one of his partners. Foolishly, you think he would have learned after Groot squish, but I guess in the heat of the moment, stuff happens. Now, Drax underneath this ship is a little upset because Drax has a love story with Mantis. So Drax is going to react in a way that, well, you would react in a way if your loved one got attacked by an alien. He's going to try to go in head on with his fists and everything because he's stupid. He's not really bright. The big guys usually aren't. Hey. And sorry about that, Tony. And before you know it, he runs out from underneath the ship, and what do you know what happens? Bam. One of them drops down, pulls him up, jaw goes through the skull. No more Drax. Maybe backing up underneath the ship was a bad idea. Just a little bit, because those things, they move in such a, and like I said, they're killing machines. They would move in such a silent way where they would know that this guy is going to back up, and they would do certain things that would cause the prey to be caught, which is baiting Mantis, taking her down. They're going to react how predators react. Now they're down two. They're starting to freak out. The level-headed one out of them all, Gamora, says, look, there's a cave over in there. She sees the formation of it, and she decides to tell all of them we need to make towards that cave because we think that's going to be a safer area. These creatures are everywhere here. What do you think?
You never go into a cave on an alien xenomorph-infested planet.
No, this is not going to be a good idea. They all run inside of this cave, and it's quiet at first, and all you can hear is the dripping of water.
And the dripping of venom from the jaws of the
aliens. And right. You can hear them moving like snakes. You can hear the pipes that they're crawling on, not pipes, rocks and trees that they're crawling on starting to shift. Of course, everybody is spun up. They're out of control. They don't know what to do here. They haven't had time to levelly think how to take down this opponent. Rocket sees him starting to drop. Rocket pulls out his favorite gun, starts shooting. This raccoon has dead-on accuracy. By the way, don't ever call him a raccoon. He hates that. He will rip your jaw off. He doesn't like being. He doesn't even know what a raccoon is, and he swears if he ever sees one, he's probably going to kill it. He starts flipping out, shooting the aliens all around him, not missing a single one. This causes all this acid that he has spilt to start to eat away at the floor. The cave is not a cave. The cave is the interior to a spaceship. And what do you know what happens with all the acid in the floor? It's going to let go. With the Guardians, the remainder ones, Gamora, Rocket, Groot, and Star-Lord on it. The floor comes crashing down, lands on top of what you would call pods or eggs, squishes them, and the Guardians of the Galaxy are laying on this part of the ship now, looking up at the opening hole. The aliens are starting to crawl down this hole. This does not look good for them. This does not look good at all. If you guys are listening to this, this doesn't mean I'm killing off the Guardians. I'm just adding story. I'm adding suspense to you guys. You have to have it. And I'm sorry I've had the aliens win. Well, I'm not.
No, you're not.
I like aliens. They're really cool. How can you not? And they're starting to crawl around them.
The angry mob with the torches and pitchforks is starting to crawl toward this studio, too.
Well, I'll have the ones that are Geiger fans. Wait a minute. They're hippies. I'm screwed.
They're in trouble.
So they all like the artwork and sex stuff. So, I'm in trouble.
They're in trouble.
Yeah, ladies and gentlemen,
he's holding a shovel. He has been digging.
Yeah, and if you haven't ever checked out Mr. Geiger's artwork, do so, or Geiger, however you want to say it.
Yeah, I'm not quite sure. I've said Geiger, but I don't know.
We've done this before on a show. Look it up. It is back at Chuckle's Crypt. We did a whole special for him when he passed away. Really cool. But if you ever see his artwork, a lot of it is painted up to look like penises and vaginas. He was very infatuated with those articles. Yeah, of the body. And when you look at an alien or a facehugger, you can see these parts of the human anatomy inside of them. But back to the story. The floor has crash-landed. It has landed on a bunch of pods, eggs. Gamora goes to stand up, and the first thing that happens to her is one of these eggs opens up. Not looking good, Gamora. Because the first thing that's going to happen is that facehugger is going to leap out and attach itself to Gamora's face. Now they are down. How many, George?
They're dropping like flies.
They're dropping like flies. This isn't looking good.
Ice.
Garut's not dead. He's injured. But
yes,
Gamora's not dead yet. But if you know the alien franchise, a facehugger attached to you is not a good thing. Rocket's still kicking. Star-Lord's still kicking. So they're down to 2.5. It's not looking good.
Right.
And they only have two guys that have guns, and eventually they're going to run out of ammo. So they've now landed on top of this. It has caused a lot of the pods to start opening. Rocket and Star-Lord decide to start shooting first, ask questions later. Good choice, because all those facehuggers coming at you, those numbers will catch up to you. But they end up destroying them. And at the last pop of one of the facehuggers, we'll get to what's going to happen next. But I promised George I would tell him, how does an alien get
eat?
Well,
how does it get its nourishment to turn to acid?
Right. Now, I read a thing on aliens' anatomy. It was inside of one of, it's called a book, ladies and gentlemen. And this book tells how an alien gets acid in its stomach, how it turns into the creature it turns into.
Okay.
How it basically eats and all the good stuff. And,
okay, what
and,
is the name of this book? Should I want to refer to
it's
it?
Earth Life. Aliens, Earth Life. Good book. Now, when an alien facehugger attaches to the face, it is forcing a seed into the stomach of its prey.
Right.
And stomachs are full of acid. So this creature is feasting upon the acid inside the stomach to grow. And when it has ate all the acid to the point where it doesn't have any more, it has ate enough of it to form its life form to come out. Therefore, it's out of food. It's popping out of the stomach. That's why a lot of times when you see an alien eating in a comic book or in the movie, it's feasting on the stomach juices.
Ah.
It likes the acid stomach juice. That's how it has acid for blood. It starts off feeding off of acid. Hmm. Now, this is also how it gets its shape. The amino acid inside of the stomach is a protein. And they are able to synthesize those proteins into the shapes that they get. That's why you end up having dog aliens. If it attaches to a dog, it comes out looking like a dog. If it attaches to a human, it comes out more human-like. In later comic books, it attaches to rhinos, and the things come out looking like rhinos. You get the idea where this is coming from. Whatever creature it attaches to, whatever acids it feeds off of, that's what's
right. Now this,
come out.
Right. Now, that was a comic book, a twist, right? That
was a book, which I'm going to take as lore, which has been the lore to all the comics and the movies. Everybody
well,
has
no, the fed movies
off
were first.
This. Yes, but this explained how stuff came up and how the creature did, because before that, we didn't have an explanation. No one knew.
Right.
It was one of those things where right, like, we don't know.
But in the first few movies, though, when they grew out of a human, they didn't. In other words, there's nothing human looking about
it is.
An alien xenomorph.
It's standing
other than
up.
The fact it's on two legs.
Right. Whereas when it eats a dog or something like that, it's on the four legs and it's moving around like the four legs. Or if it feasts upon themselves, they don't stand up. They're crawling around on the ground. Mm-hmm. It's the same thing where if, like, there's a comic book I have where a giant facehugger attaches to a whale. That's not good. That's not good at all. So you have this alien-like facehugger swimming around in the oceans. Comic books are awesome, folks. That's why we do Chuckles Crypt. Go back and read them. Find these books. Some of them are expensive to find and hard to find, but do so because it explains more of how the creatures come to be more than the movies do. and you get a little bit of excitement. When we come back, we're going to get to the conclusion of the story, and we're going to talk about some up-and-coming stuff as well. And, of course, after this, we get the Haunted Cabaret. And you want to stay tuned for that. I'm sure there's going to be something of topic there that we're all going to love. So let's go down to, well, we got a sound bite here, but after that, we're going to go to If You Want Blood by AC. No, sorry about that. I skipped. All Guns Blazes by Judas Priest here on Chuckle's Crypt, Rhode Island Free Radio. Them devil horns there. Yeah, don't, we'll get sued. That's a little Judas Priest there. Not a little, that's a whole lot of Judas Priest. One of my all-time favorite metal bands out there. And I am jealous because certain folks inside this room have seen them live and I have not. I'm hoping someday that problem is remedied and I get to see them. But we're at that point of the show. It's the end, and we're going to get to the end of the story. And then we got something coming up, which is really good. And we're going to go out with King Diamond's Halloween. I mean, what's better than that? And then coming up will be the Haunted Cabaret. But we've gotten to that point. This floor has dropped. The eggs have popped. And all of a sudden, the screech of a queen alien fills the air. The queen alien comes down off her egg pod. Now the guardians are sitting there going, crap, what is this? But before they are able to react, three red dots appear on top of the queen's face. And with a moment's notice, a cannon is launched and the queen's face is blown right off like a zit off your face. Now the guardians are really like, whoa, what's this? And they all back up against each other, what's left of them. And Groot picks up Gamora because he doesn't know what's wrong with her. So they're going to try to save her. And they're not sure what's going on here. The guns are loaded. They're looking around. And right in front of Groot appears a predator. And the predator stares him down, the Groot, and that's where this story ends. And this is up to you, the listeners, that just listen to this whole story to come up with the ending. And remember, send it to the Chuckles and Laughs show at yahoo.com. I will read it off, your ending, next time we're on air. Which next time we're on air, we're doing the Disney Afternoon. Who doesn't like Disney Afternoon? I know I do. What do you think, George? You didn't see the Predator coming in that one, did you?
No, I didn't.
And now, is it going to be in their odds, or is it going to be a whole nother shit show?
Well, it depends who this Predators decide to open fire on more.
Now, this is up to the listeners. This is where it's fun.
That's what I'm just saying. Yeah. The listeners have options.
You have the options to come up with this. I gave you guys the false cards. Gamora's not dead yet. The cards are laid down. You just got to put them in the correct order.
One might even say, you have the power.
Oh, I love that. Thanks, George. No, Tony, George, too much coffee without alcohol. Coming up July 15th and 16th at the Assembly Theater in Harrisville, Rhode Island, Chuckles the Clown will be at Ocean State Paragon, have its own celebrity booth, along with Rhode Island Free Radio's one and only DJ Psycho Eddie and Tony Jones.
And I hear that Mr. Ken DaCosta will be making the rounds down here at Rhode Island Free Radio pretty soon to talk about the event. So.
Good. Maybe I can get him down here when we do the we'll get him down for Chuckles Cryptozoology.
We can have him investigate the building afterwards.
Yeah, it's a really cool. I got some good stuff from there, and I show Tony's not going to come back into this building ever again. Ladies and gentlemen, it's the end of the show. You got when I'm coming up. Come up with your ideas, and we're going to head things out with King Diamond's Halloween here on Chuckles Crypt, Rhode Island Free Radio. I hope you enjoyed. Coming up next.